All right, I think we'll go ahead and get started. My name is Chip Oskerson. I'm the Acting Associate Director for the Center for the Study of Europe, and I'm delighted to welcome you here today to today's Café CSE, the last Café CSE of the semester. We're glad that you made it out, and I think that you'll find the discussion that we're going to have here today really rewarding. Very briefly, I want to draw your attention to the slide. I think most of you know what this is all about, but if you text in as indicated here, you can enter yourself into a drawing for one of our three prizes today, a deluxe edition of some of the folklore we'll be talking about. And Fairytales that we'll be talking about. Also, entering in will give you an entry into our prize to at the end of the academic year to give away a plane ticket to Europe. So encourage you to go ahead and do this, and we'll be taking this down in just a second. Our discussion today is going to be recorded and broadcast on BYU radio, and so if you're interested in hearing it again tomorrow or recommending it to a friend, it'll be broadcast tomorrow at noon. And this is on, you can find online at byuradio.org or on the Sirius XM channel 143. Today, as the speakers are presenting to us, there'll be a couple of sign-up sheets going around where you can give us your email and contact information. We can notify you of other events that are being sponsored by the Center for the Study of Europe. And as well, you can give us feedback on your experience here today. The topic for today is an exciting one. When I first went to graduate school at UC Berkeley, it was at the height of the era of Alan Dundas and the folklore program at Berkeley. He was a legend even in his own time, and this is before he died of a heart attack mid-sentence in a lecture, which only added to the folklore about the great folklorist, right? But what I encountered were students that were doing all kinds of interesting projects that had nothing to do with the kind of the high art that I had associated with the humanities up to that point. I was a student of the book, and they were talking about things that you couldn't even describe as text, even stretching the boundaries of what a text was. I perhaps believed in the death of the author, but I wanted to be the person to kill the author, whereas they were fully at home in studying all manner of things that had to do with culture in a really broad sense. In a lot of ways, folklore studies has helped to shape how we think about art and literature and our own culture for centuries. And we're going to hear a little bit more about this today, that things coming out of proto-folklore studies, even from Romanticism, have changed how we think about art. And now after graduate studies, I think about what I do very differently, and a lot of this is because of this kind of work. Our topic today is going to be looking at the idea of fairy tales, why we tell the kinds of stories we do and how they communicate deep kinds of cultural truths to us. What does it mean to talk about texts that don't have authors? And we have presenting to us today two scholars from here on campus who have thought a lot about this and are going to be able to shed a lot of light. One of our presenters is Jill Rudy, who's an associate professor of English in the Department of English. She received her PhD from the Folklore Institute at Indiana University in Bloomington. At BYU, she's worked as the director of the William A. Wilson Folklore Archives and was, until last year, the coordinator for the American Studies Program. Her research interest includes much about local folklore, about the institutional structures of folklore studies, and about Native American folklore. With her will be Professor Nathaniel Kramer, who is an assistant professor of interdisciplinary humanities here at BYU, and I'm glad to say one of my colleagues. He received his PhD from the Scandinavian program at UCLA, where he first started working on the writings of Hans Christian Andersen, who we'll hear quite a bit about today. His research explores many topics related to folklore, to fairy tales, to memory, to Hans Christian Andersen, to Søren Kierkegaard, and he even teaches a class here on Hans Christian Andersen, which I can highly recommend to you, and I know that some of you are here that might recommend it as well. But he's been interested in this, in the role of fairy tales and folk tales in literature as well. Just to let you know about the logistics about how we'll run today, I'll invite the presenters to come on up and have a seat up on our stand here. Crack open your bottle of Perrier. We'll go with our discussion until about 20 till, and at that point we're going to open it up for question and answers. Because this is being recorded, we ask that you come over here to ask your questions, and then we'll go to about 5 o'clock, at which time our reception will start, and our conversation can continue out into the hall where the CSE staff, especially Brenda Christensen, has done a great job of preparing a reception for us. So without further ado, we'll turn the time over to our presenters. Join with me in welcoming Professors Kramer and Rudy.
So I have to, is that on? Can you hear me? I have to tell you that one of my colleagues sent his regrets yesterday that he couldn't come to this. And he said, I'm sorry, and he phrased it as this, I'm sorry I won't be able to make the fairy tales and cake. And I thought, well, that is rather appropriate. We often think about fairy tales and cake, and that seems to be what fairy tales are about. It's kind of the icing, as it were, a lot of fluff. So we're gonna talk a little bit about that. I did wanna just preface what we're gonna talk about a little bit. Today, I've been trying to get with Jill for quite a while. She does folklore, I do Hans Christian Andersen, and so I've been, every time I see her, so we really should get together. So this was a great opportunity for us to get together, so we appreciate Cafe CSE for letting us do this or encouraging us to get together. So my interests primarily have to do with Hans Christian Andersen, and do deal some with folklore, and so I was interested in Jill's expertise in this area and how Andersen fits into that issue of folklore. And Andersen, interestingly enough, describes his life as a fairy tale. And I think you can take that a number of ways. So we want to explore a little bit about what Andersen means by his life as a folk tale or a fairy tale a little bit as well. And we want to then reach to the idea of story itself and why we find stories so compelling. What is it about stories that are so interesting to us? And our world, of course, is saturated with the idea of story, right? I mean, the media we consume is filled with stories. We tell stories when we get together and talk as friends and family, and we also tell our own selves stories, right? We tell stories about to ourselves about who we think we are. So this is kind of the direction that we want to move in. Before we do so, so I guess we're supposed to forget you to a certain extent and talk to each other, but we wanted to talk about definitions for a moment. Folk tales, fairy tales, these mark some of the disciplinary boundaries, right, between fairy tale studies and folklore studies, and we argue about, well, what gets characterized as a folk tale and a fairy tale.
So. Right, and some folklorists care about that more than others, as we've sort of found. I think some of the people who taught you had more definite boundaries about some of that than maybe I have by now. I'm hoping that they'll, I will pretend that we're talking, but they are here.
That they are here.
And I hope that you have as much fun as we have had while we've been getting ready to do this. So it was kind of a tricky way to have a conversation to bring in a bunch of other people too. But yeah. I'm glad that we're doing it. It's kind of a weird time. I feel like we've kind of given ourselves a final. So I'm going to suggest maybe some homework too towards the end of this. But with the idea of a fairy tale or a folk tale. A fairy tale is pretty much what people think it is. It's a story that starts once upon a time, and it tends to end happily ever after. And in between, there's usually some sort of protagonist who faces some sort of challenge, and there's often a helper who comes along. They learn something about themselves, and it ends up all well in the end, at least for the protagonists. There's some interesting stuff that happens along the way that some of my students have pointed out. I'm also teaching a 495 English Junior Seminar this semester on fairy tales, so we've been working with this a lot. Fairy tales, we like them, I think, because we talked about this. There's romance, there's adventure, and part of it is, this is where folk tale comes in. The fairy tale, this is our only reference to Europe, so so enjoy this, but part of that story, the protagonist often is some sort of princess. There are castles, there are dark forests, there is a sense that we're in that land far away is somehow often European. When we see them, like in Shelley Duvall's Fairy Tale Theater or Jim Henson's The Storyteller, the costuming tends to look like maybe the Renaissance or the medieval period. Their gowns, their tights, their crowns. So there's it's vague, but there is some sense that if we did identify the land, it might be somewhere in Europe. And part of that is that Europeans collected these stories. So Charles Perrault in France in the 1697 published Tales of Times Past, and he attributed them to Mother Goose. And at the same time, there were French women salon writers, Madame d'Aulnoy, who actually came up with the term fairy tale. Mm-hmm. And so and hers were written. She was an author. She wrote novels, and she put these tales within her novels. And so it was a single author. It was different from what folklorists consider a folk tale, which is that it belongs to the people. Especially we tend to think of maybe peasants telling these stories to each other. And when folklorists and German scholars have studied these stories, the romance and the adventure, they sort of bring back that more primal aspect, and it turns into sex and violence. That there's not just whimsy and castles and princesses. There's a dark side in those challenges that those people are facing.
And this is why the fairy tales matter, right? It's because they deal with some of these deeper, darker issues of human existence. I want to come back to this idea of defining the folk tale and the fairy tale. I think this was beat into me as a graduate student, that there was this kind of very insistent categorization. And folklorists, this is what folklorists did, is they categorized, they put all these different tales in boxes. And so I was very kind of keen to that sense, well, this is not this, or this is like that. And of course, folklorists are interested in the way those folk tales and fairy tales cross boundaries, right, the kind of hybrid forms. But what about... One of the distinctions here is the issue between oral culture and a literary culture, which you began to mention, right? And that was another one of those important distinctions, that folklore, folk tales are oral. Fairy tales may or may not be, right? That they're written down, and that changes them. That does something to them.
The sense that they're oral also is part of that sense that they aren't single-authored, mm-hmm. that somehow collectively groups of people, by telling and retelling the stories, have shaped it so that it's not just one idiosyncratic person making up this story, but it's more like the story of the ages. It's coming through that particular storyteller. And the assumption does tend to be that that storyteller is speaking to someone else, like we're doing here, not writing a book.
So there's a kind of universality or generalizability that's built into the communal.
Especially when they started finding similar types of stories all around the world.
Right.
What was going on there?
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Interesting. So I want to. So, in terms of the fairy tale itself, we talked about having a fairly defined structure, right? I mean, we talk about fairy tales. We're really talking about something very specific. All folk tales aren't necessarily fairy tales, right?
Right.
What are some of those features of the fairy tale? Because this is what we want to talk about when we get to Anderson especially, and then the kind of darker.
They're especially known for being fictional, that there's something that maybe wouldn't happen in the world as we know it. A legend is more, could this have happened in the world that we live in? And the myth is more a world before it came to be as we know it, kind of a creation story.
Okay.
So. The tale is fictional, it's wondrous.
So it's a break from reality.
Yeah.
A deliberate break in some sense.
And it tends to have flat characters. A lot of times they don't even have a name. They just sort of are filling that function, mm-hmm. which Vladimir Propp identified with his 31 functions, which I always then want to go to Baskin-Robbins.
31 functions, 31 flavors.
Yeah.
So So as part of this, so there's these functions and we plug these specific characters in. So the protagonist, as long as there's somebody to fill that role, that's fine.
Right,
it could be male or female.
Right.
But then that changes the way the fairy tale is.
Or it could be an animal.
Or it could be an animal,
yeah.
Okay? But there's also, I mean, the sense, and we talked a little bit about this, that there's an arc in that fairy tale, right? That mm-hmm. that there's a move from lower status to often higher status, although we did, you know, qualify that some. Mm-hmm. Usually that fairy tale ending is you get the princess or the prince and half the kingdom, right? There's a reward for coming out at the end of this struggle, this trial. And that's what we mean by the fairy tale ending, right?
Is right.
The world is put back in place by the end.
Often that ending is a marriage. Mm-hmm. And so Anderson becomes really interesting because he clearly is the author, but his stories get retold. And so it's very interesting to think about where he fits, because I've had some of my teachers kind of say he's not a folktale. He's just pure a literary fairy tale.
Yeah.
But then when you realize the way there are variations of his stories, or sometimes people don't know that he wrote the stories that he wrote, then we start getting back into this realm of, is it a fairy tale and a folktale?
Right. So so one of the distinctions I use in my class on Anderson is, and the German is actually kind of helpful, it's the Zaubermärchen versus the Kunstmärchen. So the Zaubermärchen is the magical tale. It's the fairy tale that we've been describing, right? And all of those characters. But Anderson is involved with the Kunstmärchen. It's the art tale. It's single authored. It's written down. And there's kind of literary intent behind it, as it were. Mm-hmm. And so this idea that Anderson writes art tales and doesn't write folk tales or fairy tales, I think, is a distinction I use throughout my class. And this means that Anderson is doing something slightly different, right?
Right.
Than those folktales.
But then the question always is then, did he just make it up all on his own?
Yeah, no, so Princess and the Pea might be a good example of this. So Princess and the Pea, Anderson, a lot of people, as you mentioned, don't know that this Hans Christian Andersen mm-hmm. actually wrote this. This is not a folktale in the sense of an oral tale that was, you know, disseminated broadly. It's single authored. There's one version of this, the published version of it. But what's interesting about this is he drew off of folktale material. There's actually a folktale that he names. It's the Princess of Kattenberg that he actually derived this from. And so the question I'm interested in is why, you know, what is the relationship? And what's interesting about the Princess and the Pea is that you do have marriage. You have a prince who's looking for his princess.
A real princess.
Exactly, a real princess. That's the issue here. And they get married in the end, but Anderson doesn't stop there. It's as if that wasn't really the intent of his fairy tale. It was actually to get to another point, which is, oddly enough, about the pea. And remember, the pea is placed under these 20 down mattresses that the princess sleeps on, and she feels it through all of this. So Anderson seems to be oddly interested in this pea rather than the marriage and this hypersensitivity of this princess who's black and blue all over after sleeping a night there. So, and the other element here too with Anderson and why it's more of a literary tale is that Anderson pays a great deal of attention to the language. That you mentioned the real princess. That word is actually italicized throughout in the tale, and it's relatively short, so it occurs, I think, four or five times in the italicized version. So Anderson is pointing us to the fact of the real, the issue of the real, what qualifies as a real princess. And that's not possible in an oral tale, right? I mean, you couldn't draw attention in the same way that you could in a written text to this issue of reality or the realness of the princess. So
what's up with the P?
Well, I mean, I don't know. I mean, it's kind of interesting. He ends the tale with the pea being in a museum, the Royal Danish Museum, if you want to go look at it, it's there. So there's a kind of metafictional or metatextual question going on about not just the real princess, but the reality of the story itself. Is this even a real story? And he even concludes his very last line is, now that was a real story. So he's constantly playing with this idea of the fictional, the fantastic versus the real and, and reality.
So is there really a museum with that name?
Yes, there is.
Okay, yeah, so and that's...
And in fact, it seems like there's a reference to, the reference is actually to some golden horns that were dug up in Denmark that were actually stolen from the museum and melted down, and we don't know what happened to them. So there seems to be a kind of nod to this, to those in the know.
Okay, but when it got translated into English, it was fantastic enough that the version my students have read has, they put three P's under the all of the mattresses because it just seemed somehow too incredible that she could feel it from one, but somehow ramping it up
three.
To three.
Really?
Yes, yeah.
So you can feel three, but not the one.
Right, right. But, yeah. You know, it fits because that's part we didn't mention about these tales is that they do tend to have things happen in threes. There are three episodes. You know, if you know the Grimm version rather than the Disney version of Snow White, with which comes three times.
Right, right. That law of threes that runs throughout the fairy tale. Things happen in threes, so
right.
Be careful.
Right. So even in the translation, they still were in the mode of this genre.
One thing we wanted to talk about, though, was that The Princess and the Pea is still a cute, fun tale, right? I mean, it's fun to read and fun to listen to, but there are darker sides here to these fairy tales, right? And Anderson, of course, ramps up the darkness in some of his tales. I mean, I was thinking about the Little Mermaid, but what about this darker element in these tales? Why is that there?
Well, it goes back to what we were saying about the working through of these key issues in life to recognize that life isn't all easy, but then the helper often comes along. Who are these stories for is part of what we need to be thinking about too.
Yeah.
Are these for someone who's already grown up and sort of knows that the world could be a hard place? Are these stories for children that is sort of maybe warning them that it could be hard times could be out there?
Well, this is something I think that's been productive in our discussion in preparation for this. Is that I had it drummed in me, you know, as a graduate student, that one of my professors used to say that Anderson is not kiddie lit. He's not children's literature. There's something more artistic than children's literature. But as you kind of push that a little bit, children's literature itself can be fairly complex and often very violent, dangerous. We talked a little bit about Bruno Bettelheim as a figure who saw this. The darkness entails as a way for children to actually deal with the difficulties of an adult world as they kind of move from childhood into adulthood. These become ways of imagining what it's like to be an adult, right? To move into that adult world.
Right. So. And another scholar, Maria Tatar, is the one who sort of brought people's attention to the dark side of the Grimms. She wrote a book called The Hard Facts of the Grimms Tales in the 1980s. And she wrote the chapter about sex and violence, and she noted that the Grimms were willing to include or even kind of add to the violence of the stories they collected, but they really cleaned up any sexual references, I mean, as much as they could, given that the symbolism of the stories still kind of lets that in, because it was meant for children.
Yeah.
So we get back to who is the audience?
Who is the audience, right?
For these stories.
Right. Well, with the idea of the Little Mermaid, so this is, and the reason we bring this up is because there's a Disney version that actually people know better than the original Anderson version, right? So,
right.
So.
Which brings us back to the, you know, fairy tale, folktale thing. Anderson is then acting kind of more like a folktale because
right.
People know the version, although some folklorists freak out about Disney and movies having a role
right.
In returning to the folk.
And as I mentioned, there's actually a scholar who sees the Disney version as actually truer to the folktale version or to folktale structure than actually Anderson. Anderson departs here. And so One of these departures is kind of interesting. In the Disney version, of course, everything winds up happily in the end, right? Mm-hmm. The Little Mermaid gets the prince, and they live happily ever after.
Right.
But in the Anderson version, it's interesting because we don't even start really with this pursuit of marriage in the first place. That's not really what the Little Mermaid is even after. She's after an immortal soul, which seems a very odd thing for a fairy tale to be involved in, right?
Right.
Is this immortal soul.
That really wasn't one of Prop's functions.
Yeah, that's not one of those functions. There's not even a place for that, right, in there. And then as they move, as you move throughout the arc of the story, you arrive at the end, and you realize that she's not going to actually get the prince, that the prince is actually going to marry someone else. And if you know the fairy tale structure.
Yeah, you've got to keep going.
Yeah, you're like, well, wait just a moment. This isn't supposed to happen. And then she's offered a choice. She can return back to the Merworld, but she has to kill the prince. And she's handed a knife by her sisters to kill the prince. And this is, again, very unfairytale-like. She ends up throwing the knife into the sea and is ready to embrace her death. The sun comes up, and she's ready to embrace her own death. And then at that moment, she's made into what the Anderson text refers to as one of the daughters of the air. And so she still has the possibility of getting an immortal soul, but she has to now wait 200 years. She has to serve out this kind of purgatorial sentence, in a way, doing good deeds, right? And mm-hmm. so that ending is very un-fairy tale-like. It moves very different directions. And so I think anybody who's familiar with folk tales and fairy tales begins to wonder, well, what is going on here? And not just that, but there is a great deal of pain and suffering in Anderson's tale. She's described when she gets, one of the prices she pays to be able to walk on land is her tongue gets cut out. And I mean, the Grimm brothers do this too, right? I mean, there are lots of amputations and things like that going on. But there's also her legs, she's walking on her legs, it feels like knives are cutting her. So, I mean, versus the Disney version, this is a very, very strange kind of frightening, sad tale in a lot of ways, in comparison. So, I mean, going back to this darker side of these tales, why?
Why? What's interesting with Anderson is that he was there, he was doing it in the 19th century, and then it makes it more interesting that Disney kind of returns to the more clear, happy ending. And part of the reason I think there's a kind of return to the dark side of tales, especially in movies and television, is because of that pervasive effect of Disney. And then of scholars coming along and saying, no, wait a second, there's more to these stories than just the cute dancing dwarves and the animals. So scholars have reminded us that there's, you know, sex and violence is part of this almost primal aspect of folk tales. Disney is so cute in many ways, even though he still is dark. I mean, I am one who was terrified by that witch in Snow White, so
yeah.
He doesn't gloss over it. But part of it is where it's gone in our culture, too. you mentioned she isn't even named, right?
Right.
In
She's
The Little Mermaid.
That's right.
So it's that part fits the kind of flat aspect. So Disney gives her a name,
right?
And now she's part of those Disney princesses. It's a whole marketing.
Couldn't escape it in the class I was teaching, right? She was often referred to as Ariel, despite the fact that, you know, she's not named in Anderson's text at all. So there really is this kind of interesting convergence of these two tales that we can't. And Disney's become part of Anderson, and likewise.
Yes, it's happened in my class too, where students would be talking about Beauty and the Beast, not necessarily about Disney's version, and she would be called Belle. And
yeah.
So, yes. So I think partly because Disney has become so pervasive, so successful at selling this, that one way to maybe even keep us interested to make a shift from the child version to the adult version is to then kind of say, let's see what we can do with these.
Mm-hmm.
And they're malleable enough that they handle it. So when I started in my intro to folklore class, I had students start a fairy tale unit, and they had to go find examples of fairy tales now. And so the first group that presented on Snow White presented the day that Sydney White and the Seven Dorks was premiering. Okay, that's not dark. That I don't know quite what that is, but it's playing with it. It's giving us another version, but it's not very dark. But recently we've had Snow White and the Huntsman, which right. is definitely a darker turn. My students have told me about Hansel and Gretel, Witch Hunters. We have the TV shows, Grimm and Once Upon a Time,
right.
where there are evil characters. They're not necessarily aimed at children. There's usually some aspect of the world's either existing, the fairy tale world and Storybrooke, Maine being parallel, or is that magic going to be able to intersect into our real world?
Right.
So there's an exploration of just kind of more range of possibilities of what these stories are really doing.
So this commercialization, this kind of reappropriation of the folktale into Hollywood is not necessarily a bad thing then. Is that what you're saying? That
not necessarily.
That it's kind of a reimagining of the folktale again? I mean, that it already is a form, allows for, and it encourages a kind of exchangeability, as it were, kind of moving characters in and out, new circumstances, new events.
Right.
While still maintaining that kind of general structure.
But the process, of needing to buy the Disney branded exact lookalike, that does still get
yeah.
a little problematic. I think we have to keep in the back of our heads, even as
right.
this become, it's enjoyable. And some feminists have written about, do I let my daughter play Disney princess?
Right.
How, what is she learning? Is she just going to be passive or someone else's commodity?
Well, we talked about the idea that the fairy tale ending suggests a kind of conservatism, right? Mm-hmm. That after whoever our protagonist is goes out into the world, meets these monsters, deals with these challenges, the whole world gets put back together, right? And it gets put back together through marriage, right? The prince and the princess are united. They get half the kingdom. The status quo is then put back in place. And I think you mentioned Jack Zipes was particularly incensed by Anderson in some sense that the world gets put back in place. It becomes the same thing over and over again. And that, rather than recognizing the revolutionary or radical possibilities,
right.
it becomes this fairy tale ending once again. So yeah, what do you make of that?
I think there are some conservative elements to it. But again, feminists especially have been pretty prominent for the past few decades trying to rewrite it. And sometimes it's interesting to see how Disney then works its way back in. I've been thinking of the movie Enchanted and how the dad gives his daughter this biography of real wonderful women, and the daughter doesn't really like it. She doesn't want to read it. There's something, we sense that there's something more fun about these fantastic stories. And so, but along the way, there really have been changes. And that's something some of my students have been noting too, that really as the ideas about women's roles change in society,
okay.
even the Disney princesses become more proactive. They aren't just sitting and singing songs about waiting for their prince to come. There's still gonna be problems with that if it just flips it and then she becomes just a warrior or something. But again, there really are possibilities with this type of story.
Right, Tatar, I think, makes this point too, that fairy tales would not capture our imagination if they simply moralized the entire time, right? If we got to the end and it was all about, this kind of moralizing or morality that we're supposed to, we're reinforcing every single time, they wouldn't last, right? But it's the complexity of the fairy tale, right? It's the possibility that we insert these other characters, these other events in, and that does something different, and that becomes provocative in a way.
Well, and I think
it kind of forces us to reimagine or think about something different, right? Or different endings, different conclusions.
Right, and I think that's part of why they still matter. Is they work very well with just that very sense of a human need. I'm going to do Wordsworth, similitude and dissimilitude, and the other way around. That there's a pattern, and it can vary. And I think the turn to the dark is showing. Wow, we thought they were this way, but look at what they can do.
So I want to, since we're kind of coming to our point here.
Yeah.
I mean, what about this idea of fairy tales and cake? You know, this idea of icing. I mean, so I was thinking about why fairy tales matter. It's easy, I think, to go the other way and ask the question, well, do fairy tales really matter? And why don't they? Why should we think that they don't matter? And I think there's some concern about fairy tales. I mean, fairy tales are escapists. They're something that we go to. They're entertaining. They're fun. But really irrelevant in the long run, that they're not really that important. We should spend our time, you know, doing more important things, like, you know.
Or we should maybe be happy when we outgrow them, that
yeah.
they're for a certain time of our life.
Yeah, they're for our childhood, and yes, we become adults and that we move on from these fairy tales. So that's the concern, right, is that fairy tales really aren't all that significant or important. But we're claiming that they are, so why are they significant?
I'll go back to where I just was. Let's not go there. Let's go to that they are story.
Okay.
I think there's something just important in that it is a story, and that it happened, and the sense that it's fiction.
Okay.
But the ways that something unexpected, something fantastic could come into a sort of real situation. There's something about this combination of both the real and the fantasy.
Okay.
The TV shows are playing on that, but I think that's something about the genre and then the possibility of story itself. When, you know, we can take some of our events and recast them by leaving some parts out and highlighting some parts. There's something about narrative that we shouldn't outgrow.
Okay. So I want to push this point a little bit further about the relationship between the fantastic and our real world.
Mm-hmm.
So if we read, if we're looking at fairy tales as escapism, what we do is we read those to escape from our real world, our banal, everyday world. That this lets us go and explore something else. It's the what if, right? It's
mm-hmm.
So imagine something, the world otherwise. But does the fairy tale have any connection to our world? I think it does. I mean, I think the idea that what the fairy tale allows us to do is imagine our world differently. That there is a kind of, if we go out to the fairy tale to escape from our world, it returns us in very interesting ways back to our world. I think I mentioned the provost piece where
mm-hmm.
she reads this Belgian children's writer. She writes this letter to Hans Christian Andersen every couple of years. And she talks about the story of a mother, and she's so upset at Andersen because in the story of a mother, the mother is able to track down death to get her child back. And she's bothered by this as a mother. She says, that doesn't happen. Nobody gets the opportunity to chase death and the opportunity to bring their child back to life. And so she's upset at Andersen all the way through this letter. And then she realizes, I think as she gets to the very end, that what Andersen isn't doing is simply letting us out of the world, imagining how nice it would be to be able to get my child back, but that it returns us back to the way our world is, and that we should, and she calls this the fatal instant, the transcendent possibilities of the fatal instant, that when that child has died, that's a moment where seemingly everything in her life converges in that final fatal instant. And it's the way Andersen takes that instant and expands it out and explores the possibility of that and what it means as a moment of transcendent hope that really becomes interesting. And so it's not letting us out of the world, it brings us back into the world of time and our experience here, that really she finds the value in that tale. And I find that rather compelling of why fairy tales matters. They take us out to the fantastic, but really to return us back to the world that we live in.
Right, and what was interesting to me, since I hadn't read that Andersen story, was to read her letter, and she sets it up in a very quotidian, mundane setting where she's going to make dinner for her children,
right.
And she drops the grocery bag, and so the tomato sauce is all over her floor, so she has this very specific, mundane thing that she needs to be doing. But it's reminding her of her children because she was going to make this
yeah.
sauce that they wanted for dinner. And so it's connecting her to her children. And if that event were to happen, the death of the child, what mother wouldn't want to then run after death and make a bargain?
Yeah.
And so what was interesting to me at the end of that essay is when she talks about what happens in the story, because again, Anderson sort of is doing interesting things with the ending. She doesn't, death, she's going to pick up these flowers that I guess would result in the death of other children.
Each child is symbolized in these plants, and death is a gardener, right? And so she's ready to kind of rip these plants out and, you know, get at death by killing these other children.
Okay. And death is a death that reminds her that another mother.
Yes.
He just reminds her, you are so sad. Would you do this to someone else? And she decides, no, she couldn't do that. So Provost recognizes there's something in this too about connectedness. These stories help us connect with other people. And that's not trivial.
No, and well, and interesting too, you mentioned the kind of context for this. She actually reads this to her children in place of the bolognese that they were going to eat, and she had something else. She reads over dinner the story of a mother, right? So there is this, I mean, we return back to this idea of the communal too, I think, is the kind of connections that are made through the fairy tales. We reimagine our world, so.
Right.
Is that?
I knew we would end on a nice cheery note here, right? Okay, well, we have a few minutes now for question and answers. So come on down over here to the microphone on the side, and you can form a line if you have a question here. As people make their way down, I thought I would start off with a question. And that question is, and you touched on this on very, very briefly, but it has to do with the notion of childhood, right? And the idea that a fairy tale is for children. What does this say to us about the, why do they emerge at the particular time they do and in the way they do? And what is that actually saying to us about the idea of childhood and the formation of childhood? What's appropriate for a child versus what's not appropriate for a child? And there's got to be historical variability in that, right?
I think so. I mean, I think there's a great deal of historical variability. We talk about this in the Anderson class, is that there's this kind of creation of the child, this imagining of a child in the Danish 19th century. And Anderson actually is credited with kind of changing the way that we think about children, at least the Danes thought about children, is there was a sense that folk tales were good and healthy because they moralized at the end, and they instructed children, they taught them how to behave. But Anderson comes along and he's rather subversive, and so this caught a lot of people, this made a lot of people concerned about what Anderson was doing, and raised the question, are these for children? In fact, his first two collections are titled explicitly for children, and he drops this, in his later collections because clearly there's something else going on there that he wanted to capitalize on. But I also think with regard to the child as well that I think Bettelheim becomes a really interesting person in this regard, is that we often point out in the Anderson class that the children here are not, they're not 10 and younger. They're usually 13, 14, 15. They reach confirmation age. They're at that stage of life, puberty. And so there's this transitional phase from the child into this adult sphere that becomes particularly tense and difficult and troubling. And this is where the conflicts come in. And so I think there's the way the child is imagined here, at least in Anderson, is one of conflict in some ways, that they're encountering this adult world that is troubling and difficult to manage. So.
You're good. Good, we'll take our first question.
Hi, I really enjoyed the lecture, it was very interesting. And at one point you briefly mentioned film and the effect that it's had on fairy and folk tales, and maybe what some of the folk tale purists have thought about it. But I want to know what you think about it. Do you think that film, in a sense, affects fairy and folk tales and what they try to do in a good way or a bad way? Do you feel that, for lack of a better word, it maybe bastardizes them in a bad way? Or what do you think?
I think it. Jack Zipes, who is one of these prominent fairy tale scholars, wrote an essay called Breaking the Disney Spell, and he really kind of went after Disney for for commercializing and sort of ruining tales. And he did admit that in a way, by having people at least go together and sitting together in a theater, it is sort of making it more communal. And I'd like to go with that part, kind of. Yes, there are problems with Disney becoming a media conglomerate and selling us lots of things, but there is something about film that is, it's a very good medium for telling stories. And that's, I'm fascinated to see how these films keep coming out. You know, my students now tell me, oh, Guillermo del Toro is going to do Beauty and the Beast with Emma Watson. And, you know, I have a website if you want more information that you can sort of, some of these scholars keep track of where are these stories coming out and what's up next. So I think it's just another way of telling stories. And I'll mention television too, just because it didn't come up. But, I did with the TV shows, Once Upon a Time in Grimm. But that's another way of telling stories, which because of advertisements, it connects us again in very interesting, troubling, but kind of opening some things up ways with commercialization and just the spreading of stories.
But I think, too, there's almost this repository of story, right, that Hollywood constantly returns back to kind of reinvigorate, to draw from, to kind of reinvigorate their own, you know, their own storytelling. They always draw, they return back to these sources, too, which is really interesting. So it's this constant reappropriation of things that we, you know, read when we were younger.
Right. And if you remember TV, then it wasn't always just Disney. You know, I grew up in the Rocky and Bullwinkle era of fractured Fairytales. And they covered a lot of different stories. Mm. Sometimes we still tend to just be doing the same few stories, but Fractured Fairytales they found a lot of stories, and then they did interesting things with them, too. So, yeah, there's a lot going on when we add in more media.
I think it's fitting that in 2 days on the museum here on campus, there's an exhibit opening. Called We Could Be Heroes, The Mythology of Heroes and Monsters in Art. And I wanted to know, I've been researching with that exhibit. There's a section in there on violence and whether sanitized violence is actually beneficial for children or not. And I wasn't sure really what critics in your fields are saying about that. You know, is Disney sanitizing violence too much to the point where it's trivialized, or does it help teach an important lesson? What's your take?
That's a loaded question.
But you're the Bettelheim guy, so we'll let you start.
Well, I think it's a good question. I don't know that it can be answered generally, but in terms of critics, so one of the authors I'm interested in, he writes kind of Anderson-like fairy tales, but he wrote this story called Child's Play, in which these two boys are playing with a playmate, and they get it into their head that this boy is sick and they're going to help him out by amputating his leg. And it's all, the story is called Child's Play. And it's absolutely horrible story. I mean, these boys, you know, this little boy dies, and the two other boys don't really comprehend exactly what's happened. And Sorensen took a great deal of heat for this. People thought he was absolutely evil for writing such a story. I mean, people called in when he read it over the radio and got upset by this. So the issue of violence, I think, is a really important part of the idea of the folktale. I'm not sure, you know, whether one can weigh in. I think it's maybe a personal decision in some ways. Mm-hmm. But I do think that Bettelheim at least would say, no, it's good. That this is where you really do confront the difficulty, right? If you take out that violent element, if you take out the real conflict, mm-hmm. then you've done away with the essential basic characteristic of the fairy tale. And then it's meaningless. It doesn't have the effect that it should. If we're really going to confront what's difficult or challenging in that fairy tale world, truthfully, then it has to be there. So I think that would be my point. But there have actually been studies done where parents don't want their children to read fairy tales because they're so violent. And there have been times in the history of folklore where they've taken out the bad stuff, right? The violent stuff, the sex. We got to get rid of that. We've got to sanitize it. But we lose something, I think. I lose, actually, I think a lot when we sanitize it in that way.
So I know that you're mainly focused in the European fairy tales and in Danish culture and German culture, but my curiosity is I've heard some things about, I don't know how reliable sources are, but of like stories like Cinderella or Snow White or Rapunzel, well, I don't know about Rapunzel, but mostly Cinderella and Snow White, I've heard transferred into like Eastern culture and Asian cultures and how they have similar folk tales and fairy tales that have similar themes as these European fairy tales. And I don't know if you know anything about that or can shed some light on like how these fairy tales can be universally shown even in like Asian culture, but I don't know if you know much about it.
What I have heard is that it actually, especially with Cinderella, there is a sense that it started in China, mm-hmm. and then dispersed to other places around the world. But it's the recognizable kind of, maybe some of props functions, but it also has some very different elements, which then make it interesting to see how the values change, both culturally and over time. But I have friends who published a new anthology of fairy tales for Broadview, and they start with an Egyptian story. So there definitely is a sense. And even Europeans in the 19th century, there was this India phase where they tended to, if they were tracing where the stories came from, often it was, oh, look, it's India. So there definitely is a sense of the importance of the East, even if it is a kind of orientalized in some ways. And even up to the 1950s, the first person who got a PhD in folklore in the United States did this study of the story called The Kind and the Unkind Girls. And he found lots of versions from all over the world. And then the point was to try to say, where and when did this start? And even his answer was, India. So they're definitely, it's while there's a European component, it is global.
Let me insert a question here real quick. You mentioned in passing that we have several examples, for example, of Snow White, right, that have come out in recent, just last few months, right? What does that say about our culture at this particular given moment, right? So if we're to read these fairy tales and their emergence at certain times and their predominance at certain times, as a kind of negative imprint of the culture that's receiving them and consuming them, right? What is our particular moment in terms of the fairy tales that seem to be most actual, most current right now? What is it saying about our contemporary moment, our contemporary culture?
My friends and colleagues who did that anthology were asked that question. They visited campus a few months ago. They were so involved in their 19th century and 18th century France, they didn't have a good answer, which I wish they would have, because I've thought about it and I don't have a good answer, but they seemed like they hadn't even really thought of it. So thank you to my students who keep me aware of what pop culture is doing with these stories. Snow White. Thank you. I'm going to go to my students again, because we've had some of them who have kind of focused on this maybe dark turn, you know, the Snow White and the Huntsman. I mean, it's funny, when those students were first going out and finding them, they found like a Saved by the Bell version of Snow White, which definitely is not dark. And then just at home, there was a Brady Bunch version of, the Brady Bunch does seven, you know, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. So it plays back and forth. But what my students say about kind of the dark side now, one of them reads it as a distancing of fantasy in the world that we live in. That it's almost nodding too much to the real violence or what's going on. Mm-hmm. And that by making these parallel worlds of Once Upon a Time, it's not the same as when in an older version of the story of the Three Wishes, the fairy just pops up in the room and kind of says, I'm a fairy, what is your wish? So he sees it as kind of, we don't quite do fantasy as well as maybe we did before.
You discussed, both of you discussed the appropriate audience for fairy tales. And it made me think about, in my mind growing up, I always felt that fairy tales had a very didactic purpose, that fairy tales told us how to be good or why we should be good. And I feel like Disney has definitely had a huge impact on that. But as I've read more Hans Christian Andersen and Grimm, I have been jarred by how insane and meaningless some of the things seem to be. Like all of a sudden, like, for example, like the Hans Christian Andersen with the flute and the three dogs, they're just like eating people and like killing the king left and right. And I just feel like there's no purpose to it sometimes. So I guess my question is didacticism a key component of fairy tales? Has it always been? Is it something that used to be important and that we've kind of just continued on, or has it been something that we've integrated more in this era?
Was he talking about the tinderbox? Is that
the tinderbox. That's the one.
Well, I mean, when that story came out, people were really concerned about it because it didn't have that didactic purpose.
Concerned.
Yeah, I mean, there was in the reviews. Yeah, they wondered what Andersen had done here.
He cuts off the witch's head and gets away with it to get the tinderbox and all her stuff.
So it almost seems to be immoral, right? I mean,
exactly,
that's the problem with it. But I think that. It might be, the issue might be historical in the different contexts, that fairy tales, I mean, have been told in different contexts always throughout time, and that there was a period in which they did become didactic. I mean, they were intended to instruct and teach children how to behave and what to do. And you would often find these kind of appended to the ends of these fairy tales. So now you see not to do this or something like that. So. But then you'll find other fairy tales where that's not there, right? So I think it depends on where you're talking, when you're talking, who the audiences are. Folk tales, of course, were taught or were told in all kinds of contexts.
Exactly.
There are certain kinds of folk tales that are only appropriate amongst adults in, you know, far from moved from, I mean, they'd be told, my professor used to talk about being told in bars. That's where you would go, you'd hear these tales in bars. You'd go to the nursery to hear these tales. You'd go to the spinning room to hear these kinds of tales, and that's how you would organize where the appropriateness of these tales. So not always didactic, and never were intended to be didactic. They became useful in that context only within a certain historical moment. And then Andersen undoes that, again, with his tales, that they're not the kind of didactic things that people expected.
So it was a time after, from Andersen kind of undid it, and then it was not ordinary to make it didactic anymore, and then it kind of came back. Because I feel now, personally, I feel like most fairy tales are still very didactic. I don't feel like we see a lot of the same senselessness. And by senselessness, I mean like there's no real point to some things happening in the story, like just killing the witch and amoral things happening, I guess.
One of my students has noted the fairy tale qualities in horror movies. Mm-hmm. So you would think that that's just random violence, but really, that they are very didactic, and they're very meta-aware. She's referred to some movies where they will even tell you in the movie itself, you know, don't say I'll be right back, or you're the next one to die. So it is a component of it. But I love that you reminded us to contextualize, because even though they do seem to go universal, it's really important to see where they are, what specific place and time, and even the situation of the telling, or going to the theater to see it.
Mm-hmm. For sure. Thank you.
Okay, I think we have time for one more brief question.
You've kind of touched on it already a little bit, but as I've been studying Hans Christian Andersen, the fairy tale has been turned on its head a little bit in that I see the so what of it, but now I'm like, I don't really know how I could read this to my kids. I don't know if they'd understand. I don't know if the purpose is for them to go through this struggle and then arrive safe at the other end of it and they've survived or whatever. But, I mean, do you read them to your children? What context do you give them in? How much explanation do you give? And how much of it do you leave for them to kind of think about or just to go over their heads completely.
I have to tell you a funny story about this. So we were, it was Sunday night. I already told Dr. Oscarson this. It was Sunday night and we had a few hours. I thought, let's get together and watch a movie together as a family. And I've been wanting to watch this film, Rare Exports, which is a film about Santa Claus. And I thought, well, let's get in the Christmas spirit. This will be fun. It's Finnish, Scandinavian. My kids are interested in Scandinavian. It turns out Santa is a demon who eats kids in this thing. And I have a 5-year-old and an 8-year-old that were just, their eyes were wide. And I could see them looking at me like, Dad, what's going on here, right? I mean, really? You know, well, I think I ruined Christmas for the rest of their lives. The good thing is their Christmas lists are very, very short. I don't think they want Santa to come. So there is a problem here as we, you know, I mean, I have actually, I do read fairy tales to my kids, but I do, there are parts where I don't feel like I need to mention, you know, something going on, and I will kind of, you know, gloss over it. But Bettelheim does insist that this is good, that kids need to read this. They confront things as they read these tales. And it's, I mean, I've, you know, the five and 8-year-old, maybe not, but, you know, I can imagine my, you know, my older son reading those tales. And I don't think I'd censor him in those cases. I think there's something salient about confronting what is difficult and hard. And I think I would, at least in personally, I think I would be amiss if I, you know, completely sanitized everything for them.
Well, and this is why I've been talking with my students about thinking of tales as a literary genre. That could be one of the functions of literature, is that there is a sense that it's fictional, that it is constructed, and that it's a way to help us work through some of this when we aren't in the real situation of demon Santa or whatever the world may throw at us.
Thank you for your participation here, and thank you to our presenters today for what they've shared with us. Now, before you leave, we will announce the winners of our 3 volumes of Fairy Tales. You get the choice. There is a collector's edition of Hans Christian Andersen, The Complete Tales, the Grimm's Complete Fairy Tales, and The Arabian Nights, because we know the Islamic influence in Europe nowadays, right? This is a European connection. So our first winner who can come up is Troy Leninger, who can come up and you can have your choice, although I already know which one you're going to choose. The next winner is Megan Mitten. Is Megan still here? And lastly, Philip Fernberg. Thank you. Join us out in the lobby for refreshments now.